So if you look at the LEDs that we're making, and if you talk about quality of light, this is an example, not a real life example, but this is an example of an LED that we are making at the moment. So the quality of light of the LED has to do with a couple of components in an LED. So we make an individual dye, which is basically a blue dye. And the combination of the phosphor in that specific dye is going to be really important to create a white light source. So the package that is together, that is what we call the level one or the LED. And the combination of making sure that you have a good color rendering, that you have the best color over angle, all the elements of quality of light have to do with the combination of the blue dye and the phosphor that is on top of it. So I'll get back into those five elements. So we got five elements of quality of light that we focus on, where the combination of these three are going to be really important. I'll give it out a bit. So my job is to be a marketing manager for global marketing. So we talk to end users, we talk to lighting designers as well, and we hope we can get some feedback on how we can improve our LEDs. So please be open. We've identified from all our discussions that we had with supermarkets, with the end users and the lighting designers, the five elements that I would like to talk to you about. So we would like to give you an idea what for us as an LED manufacturer quality of light will mean. So we are just one element of a total system. From an LED, you're going to make a module, and there are going to be luminaires involved. So there are a lot more elements that are going to be important when you really want to focus on the quality of light in the end. But it starts with the LED. So I will go into detail what we are doing at this moment to improve that. I believe that at this moment we're in the third phase of the third generation of LEDs. I can give it up for you. The third generation of LEDs. So we started a while ago with 5mm LEDs. That's 20 to 30 years ago. And that was basically used for indicator lamps and for, for TVs, remotes, for example. About 10 years ago, that was the first 1-watt LED that was introduced into the market. So that really made sure that you could go into general lighting and really do something with LEDs to replace conventional lighting. At this moment, we are in the third generation of LEDs. The third generation of LEDs means that we want to make LEDs that are specific for different applications. An application that at this moment uses linear fluorescent light sources has a completely different quality of light requirement than a solution which has to go in retail, for example, where 10 degree beam angles are going to be really important, where center beam candle power is going to be really important. So there are different LEDs for different solutions. In some solutions, lumen density is going to be really important, so a lot of light out of a very small area. In some other areas, you really want to have a diffused light source to make your light source as the best light source for the application. And in some other areas, of course, it's always very important, but some other areas, cost is the most important driver. So for each of those applications, we're going to have different LEDs. We're going to see that. So that's, I believe, after the first 5mm LEDs, then the 1-watt LEDs, and now the really application-specific LEDs that we're going to get into the market. So there are a lot of advantages for LEDs. I'm not going to go into much detail with them. It's energy saving, it's lifetime, it's the opportunities and the possibilities to control them, design freedom, but these are all things that you really cannot stand out anymore. There's a rat race going on efficiency, there's a rat race going on lifetime, for example, but every LED manufacturer does that. Where I believe we can stand out and where LED manufacturers should stand out to really make sure that we can replace traditional light sources is quality of light. So quality of light meaning improving the binning solutions that, or the binning issues that were there initially, I'll get back to that a little bit later. The packaging flexibility, like we just discussed, making sure that it fits with the driver solutions, that it fits with an optical control, for example. So those are the things to really think in an application way to make sure that that is the way we stand out as an LED manufacturer. So that brings me to the five main elements of quality of light, where I believe that we have to focus on. The first is color spectrum and color rendering. So we're talking about CRI, we're also talking about CQS, we're talking about the GAY index, we're talking about specific R values, for example, R15, we're talking about R9. So what does it all mean? Everybody, every application has a different idea. We're talking to some Asian manufacturers, for example, that make LEDs, And they say we really need a specific R15, that's a specific white color that apparently makes Japanese skin color look really appealing. In Europe, we always talk about R9, so the R9 makes sure that the red stands out. So really, for every application, there's a different ideal color spectrum that you want to go for. It's not only about 90R CRI, it's really about much more than just that. The second one is color consistency. So color consistency really means that we want to go and make sure that when you light different LEDs, that there is no difference or no visible difference between one light source and the other light source. So I'll go into detail, and there are parameters as well that we can use to make sure that you get similar LEDs from one light source to another. The third element is the color in application. So color in application means that in the past, LEDs were always measured at 25 degrees. And LEDs are just like skin. If you are under a warm sun, your skin warms up, your skin becomes warmer, they become more red. So if you're in a cold environment, your skin becomes white, your skin becomes maybe a little bit purple if it's really cold. So LEDs behave in the same way. They're different when you use an LED at 25 degrees, at a cold temperature, it behaves different than when you use it at 85 degrees. And the thing is that when you use it in an application like a luminaire or in a lamp, the temperature could go up to 110 or 115 degrees in an application. So you really have to make sure that when you use it in an application, the color is going to be the color that you want it to be. So I'll go into detail into that as well. The fifth one is the color consistency in a beam. So also when you have a grazing light, for example, on a wall, you really want to make sure that the light in a complete beam is going to be similar. You don't want to make sure that there's a green color on the sides to make sure that, you know, when you have a nice lit wall, you're not thinking of an RGB solution. It should really be one color temperature. So you can also think about macadam ellipses there. I'll go a bit into detail about that later to measure that. And the last one is color consistency over lifetime. So what does an LED do initially? It's all nice. We can all talk about color consistency between light sources in the installation, but what if one fails? Where are we then? What is going to happen over lifetime with the LED? So we've worked with that with traditional light sources, with fluorescent, and also with CDM light sources, which we see that have some color shift. So how does it work with LED lighting? That's basically, those are the five elements of quality that I want to talk about. Anything I missed, anything you expected to be here from quality of light perspective? I'll go into a bit more detail on this a little bit later. So we as Philips and as Philips Lumileds, we have tried to make quantitative measurements to see and to qualify what those five elements of quality of light are going to be. So for color spectrum and rendering, we talked about CRI, we talked about GAY, we talked about all the different kind of solutions. That's the color rendering, that's the specification that we try to get in the first quality of light element. The second one is standard macadam ellipse. So it's less than 3 macadam ellipse that we have initiated as a standard. I'm not sure if everybody knows what the macadam ellipses are. Maybe I'll go a little bit more into detail in that a little bit later. The third one is color and application, which is the junction temperature, the 85 degree. The fourth one is color consistency in the beam, where we talk about the delta U prime V prime. That's a technical way of showing on a color chart, a CIE color chart, what the differences is between one light source and the other light source. And the last one is the color consistency over time. That is really trying to make sure that the shift of the color is going to be within boundaries of what is acceptable. And what is acceptable, that is a big discussion, of course, always. But we've tried to set with these quantitative elements a stake in the ground and make sure that that is at least the quality of light that we want to offer. So color spectrum and color rendering. Copying the spectrum of the sun, it's always easy. Yeah, we should just have the sun. We should have a spectrum which is continuous spectrum and which will make sure that we are going to be similar to the noon light of the sun. Then we've got other customers that say, well, actually, with the sun, I meant the sun at night, because that gives me a really cozy feeling. So what is it, really, copying the spectrum of the sun? CRI is, at this moment, the most used color rendering index. There are a lot of discussions going on about a new CRI discussion. There are discussions going on about a color quality scale to really measure what a quantitative measure. The disadvantage of the current CRI solutions that we have is that they're basically measured on 8 R values. Especially the saturated colors, like the colors we were mentioning before, the R9 and the R15, they're not taken into account in the CRI value. So they're having discussions on what can we do to really improve and to make sure that the color and the quantitative number that we're going to say we're going to need really reflects the right color. Because if you have a spectrum of a fluorescent light source, it's completely different as a spectrum of an incandescent lamp or even of LEDs. So it's really important. There are a lot of discussions going on, discussions about standards and new standards. They'll probably take a couple of years, so I don't expect that a lot of is going to change in the next couple of years. However, CRI is a good measurement. If you want to go and specify something, it's a first measurement to know what you're going to do. For indoor lighting, 80 CRI minimum. There are 90 CRI possibilities as well. For outdoor lighting, I don't believe that CRI really makes a big difference, but there are some outdoor municipalities that specify minimum 70 CRI. For jewelry, it's really important to know what the right color temperature is that you want to sell your products in. So I don't believe that this is a jeweler that's going to sell a lot of its products. I believe that this is a way to really make sure that your LEDs and basically also the merchandise, mainly the merchandise, is going to sparkle. Also for meat, the R9 value, if you want to have a specific red rendering, the red rendering is really important for the apples or for the tomatoes or even in a bakery. It's going to be much nicer and people see much fresher food without faking it. People see much fresher food in grocery stores or in places where red needs to be enhanced. So it's about CRI, but it's also about implementing and translating that CRI into the application by really thinking of specific R values, the R9 or the R15 or the really crisp white color to implement that. So don't only look at CRI, look at more than just the CRI. CRI is only one thing, but if you look at color spectrum, what is going to happen with your LEDs when you dim them? So this is an installation to the left, which is a nice installation. It looks perfect. It looks nice. It is actually a mix of half of the light sources, which are LEDs, and the other half are incandescent lights. It makes sense. You could even do it. You get a lot of energy saving, and it still has this nice sparkling feeling. But when you start to dim it, you really want to make sure that those light sources and the color of those lights is going to be similar. So this is a wrong example of what happened. I got this from an American lighting designer from the Lighting Design Alliance, Chip Israel, where he said, we really have to make sure that we get a similar color even when we dim the LED lights in its application. So make sure that when you want to mimic something, it's really important that you get to the same color. So should we then make all kind of lamps that get warmer, just like an incandescent lamp, when we dim it? Well, we've had some other customers and some other suppliers in the market that are, for example, doing a lot in museum lighting. Museum lighting, they will say, no, please. I love the fact that LEDs, when you dim them, that they stay exactly the same color, because I specify my paintings at a certain color temperature. And with halogen, with a UV filter in front of it, it was so difficult, because when you dim it, you get to a different color. With LEDs, that's going to be over. So it really depends, again, on the application. If it's home lighting, it's really important. If it's museum lighting, it's also important, but then it's important that they don't change color. Does it make sense? Do you have experiences in dimming LEDs and getting different colors for that? Anybody? Yeah? There are lamps at the moment being launched into the market that really try to solve this in the incandescent lamp space and in the halogen space, to really make sure that when you dim it, that it really changes color temperature just like the incandescent lamps do. The second point of quality of light is the 3 macadam ellipse point of really making sure that there is one light source and there's another light source and that they will both be the exact same color. So what is the exact same color? How do you quantify it's the exact same color? If I go to a place and I hang up two different light sources, some of the light sources, some of the people will say, I see a difference. Some other people say, I will not see a difference. People have different types of eyes. It's really difficult to find out what the real best consistency is over two light sources. So what have we done? There has been a lot of research, and we have focused on a research that has happened in already in the 1940s, 1942, by a gentleman called Arthur McAdam. And he basically found out that when you test two light sources and then you bring them a little bit closer together, you bring them closer together, every time he was asking, do you now see a difference between the two points? Do you now see a difference between the two points? Do you now see a difference between the two points? And every time he made an ellipse around his measurement result. So one McAdam is really close together. That's almost similar as the same color point on the chromaticity diagram. Two McAdam is a little bit further, three McAdam is further, five, six, seven, et cetera, et cetera. So he found out that the majority of the people will not see a difference between one light source and the other light source when you stay within three-step McAdam ellipse. So our focus is to make all our manufacturing, and also of other LED manufacturers, to make their manufacturing within three-step McAdam ellipse. And that is where for indoor lighting, I think it's going to be really important. For outdoor lighting, again, less important. Think of poles that are 10 meter high. 5 McAdam is our standard there. 3 McAdam is as Philips, the focus that we want to go for indoor lighting. If you consider that with respect or in reference with traditional lighting, it's always interesting. We always compare. We need to have fluorescent light source color quality. We need to have halogen color quality. We need to have CDM type color quality. So what is the color quality with respect to color consistency for fluorescent light sources? In the US, there is a 4 McAdam, the ANSI, the American standard, has a 4 McAdam maximum difference between one fluorescent tube and the other fluorescent tube. So if you're in the LED industry and you're at 3, you're better than fluorescent light sources. The IEC, the international standard, even has a standard of 5 McAdam for all fluorescent light sources. So if you're at 3, you're better than fluorescent light sources. For CDM, the reference in retail lighting, this is a brochure of a leading supplier, and you see that when you measure the differences between all the different kind of points, there is a color consistency of about 4 to 5 step McAdam ellipses for ceramic metal halide solutions. So if you're with LED and if you stay within 3 step McAdam, that is where we need to be. Do you specify, for example, color consistency in light sources? Is that important in projects, for example? Not really.
Maybe I have a question. How do you get the McAdam that's then related back to the color temperature?
So for every color temperature that we make, we should have a manufacturing process that gets you to 3-step McAdam. So it's the combination of the blue LED and the white phosphor. Basically, there's every time you have a blue LED and you have a white phosphor plate, matching them together gets you a color temperature. And matching them together also makes sure that you can get into a center of a 3-step McAdam for the complete color temperature that you have. Does that make sense?
Not very clear.
So, do we have the demo here? Yeah. So, remember the... If you look at the LED... Thank you. If you look at the LED light source, the thing that we make initially in our manufacturing is a blue LED. So matching that with phosphor, make sure you get a certain color temperature. Mm-hmm. We can make sure that matching this blue yellow phosphor, which is really a tile like I'm showing it here, we can measure the color points of the tile, we can measure the color points of the blue LED, and then matching them together, we can make sure that that is really at the color point where we need to be. So that gets you to this 3 McAdam ellipse point.
So all the products that we make then has the same color point. Has a color point in a different...
In 3-step McAdam, yeah, all the color points, yes, exactly. So if you want to have 5,000, we can do it. If you want to have 4,000...
It can be done at different color temperatures.
It can be done at all the color temperatures, exactly, yeah.
And how is that with other manufacturers?
Other manufacturers are also trying to improve their color quality. So you see that they have focused basically on saying there's a 2 McAdam solution and there's a 4 McAdam solution. I have not seen any other manufacturer that has its full production in 3 macadam like we're doing at the moment. But they're also moving to, because the standard was actually a couple of, we started the binning basically in 2008. It was a huge cloud of products that we made. It was improved by the ANSI that really made sure that the color points were already closer together. But this is still a 7-step macadam ellipse. This is one color point. And from over there to there, it's still a 7-step macadam ellipse. We improved that with a 5 macadam ellipse, and now we're improving that as a 3 macadam ellipse. But you see, we've come from far. And at this moment, we see that we're trying to get that within the 3-step macadam ellipse.
You get a uniform color of light in your installation.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Thanks.
Thanks for the question. So if you look at a wall, you see the full wall, which is lit completely with a randomly taken from the manufacturing LED, which makes sure that we call it freedom from binning. You don't need binning anymore, so you don't need to put one color in one bin, another color in other bin, because there is only one color. If you want 3,000 Kelvin, you're going to get 3,000 Kelvin. But then, are we there? You know, we've got 3 macadam ellipse, so are we there? Or do we need to go to 2? Do we need to go to 1? Or is there a completely different discussion that we need to go for? So if you look at the chromaticity diagram, and these are all the different color temperatures that we have, 2700, 3000, 3500, 4000. If you look at the warmer color temperatures, the real color point is at the black body line. So this is the Planckian curve, the black curve. If you go to the cooler color temperatures, you see that it gets on above the black body line. So that is the ANSI standard that has been set by the United States. ASSIST has, in combination with Rensselaer, so Rensselaer is a research agency in the United States, but it's working globally on its research on where the real color point is going to be. So they've done a check on asking customers, not really saying what this Planckian black body curve is. They've asked just to customers, do you believe this is white? Do you believe this is white? Do you believe that is white? And every time they ask customers, where do you believe the real white point is? Or consumers, basically people being in light the whole day. So it seems that this is a 4,000 Kelvin point. It seems that if you go to cooler color temperature, the real perceived white point of people like you and I is going to be above the black body line. The real perceived white point of warmer color temperatures is below the black body line. So this is an interesting one, because we as LED manufacturers, we have tried everything to get all our manufacturing at the black body line. So we are at this moment with a very small circle around this point. So now there are researchers that actually tell us that the point is here. So what do we need to do? So it's an interesting discussion what we need to do and what we can do. There are definitely advantages by getting a color point here, because your red is going to be enhanced, for example. I think the real point is that we need to make LEDs for every type of application, but it's interesting. It's not only, again, about macadam ellipses. It's really where the color is that you want to be. So LEDs and over temperature. I was telling the story about the skin, which gets a different color when you're in the sun versus when you're in Siberia, for example. So also LEDs are behaving different over these temperatures. So imagine that if you have a certain LED at 25 degrees, you think you're going to buy an LED at 25 degrees because everybody used to spec an LED at 25 degrees, then you're going to use it in your application, which is maybe 100 degrees, the color is going to be different. There's a 200 Kelvin difference if you go from 25 degrees to more than 100 degrees. So you're specifying a project, you need 3,000 Kelvin, and when you install it, it's all of a sudden almost 2,700 Kelvin. People are angry, you know, I didn't really want this color. So that is a discussion that we need to have. So the LED industry is now moving to testing LEDs at 85 degrees, and I think that's really important to keep in mind. It's 85 degrees that the new testing is going to be all about. So that might be that the products that we test are at 25 degrees, they're at these points, but at 85 degrees, they shift and they go into the black body line and really make sure that they're within 3-step macadam on the black body line. So LEDs over temperature, it changes. Really make sure that when you ask LEDs, it's tested at 85 degrees. The fourth element is color over angle. So color over angle means that there is a similar color when you buy a luminaire in over here compared to what you get in the beam itself. What at this moment the standard is in the market is this solution. So this is a standard LED in the market. This is what everybody is making. You see that there's a different color over here versus what you get in the beam itself. This is not preferred, because if you want to buy a luminaire, of course, optics can be very forgiving. If you put an optic on top of it, you will see that the color is going to be much more similar. I cannot see anybody anymore now because I looked straight into the light. So it's going to be forgiving, but you want to make sure that also within the LED itself, you're going to have a similar color over another color. So also there, the phosphor method that you want to use is going to be really critical. So there are phosphor methods that we are using at the moment, which give a color temperature and a color over angle difference, which is similar in the outside part as well as in the inside of the beam. That's going to be really important. So if you want to use this as a grazing light, this is a specification that we want to go for. So what kind of quantitative measurement do we want to take for that one? So basically, again, it was the phosphor method that's going to be really important. You want to make sure that over here and over there, there's going to be a similar solution. So this is the phosphor method that we need to use. So we call it a delta U prime V prime. So there are different points that we can measure on the color chromaticity diagram to make sure that one color is similar than the other color. So you want to see that the color in the center versus the color in the angle is going to be the same. So this shouldn't go up too big. This was the light that I showed you in the first place. So a standard LED in the market has about 30 or 0.03 delta U prime V prime differences. We stay with our LEDs now also within 10 points difference. So really make sure you ask for the 10 points difference, or you ask for a color over angle qualification for the different LEDs themselves. The last point I wanted to mention is really the stability over time. If you want to make sure that you have LEDs in a certain system, maybe one fails after 2 or 3 years, you want to make sure that if you install a new LED, that that's going to be of a similar color as what you had 2 years ago. So it already helps that we get all our LEDs at a single three-step macadamy ellipse, because that makes sure that if you have three-step macadamy ellipse right now, it's going to be three-step macadamy ellipse also over time. But we test our measure, we test our LEDs as well. So we have a lot of testing going on and extrapolation going on how the color shift, 1 or 2 points, is going to be over life. And it's going to be different with different application, with different temperatures and with different drive currents of your LED. So it's really important to make sure that you know what the color shift is over time. There are standards like LM80, where Kai will go a bit more in detail about, that really make sure that you stay within a certain boundary. We have said that if we want to be successful with LEDs, we need to stay within a 5-step macadamy ellipse over lifetime. This is similar as what compact fluorescent or fluorescent light sources or the CDM light sources are specifying at this moment. So we want to be similar to what traditional light sources are doing there. Lastly, it's important to know that, again, we make the individual LED. So these are the small LEDs that we have. I have a little demo up there. An LED is just one component out of a total system. There are connectors, which are going to be important. There are drivers, which are going to be important. Optics that are going to be important. If you have bad optics and the optics get dirty, then your lumen and your color might shift in a different direction. If you don't have good solar solutions, it might go out. So it's really one part of the total system. And it's really, as an LED manufacturer, we are trying to do everything to have the best quality of light, but the LED system, the luminaire or the lamp, that in the end will determine how it behaves in the application. So to summarize, the 5 main elements of quality of light that I hope we can all talk upon and basically make sure that that is the focus that we're going to have as a company. And I think we have to ask also from the end user market and the lighting designer market back to the luminaire manufacturer, really talk more. Don't only ask for the CRI value, really ask more than just CRI. make sure that you know what the color consistency is of the LED versus the other LED, or the one light source for the other, versus the other light source. Make sure that it's tested. Don't just ask, are you using 3000 Kelvin LEDs? Are those LEDs 3000 Kelvin in the application? Are those 3000 Kelvin in the bulb? That's important. Make sure that the angle, has it been tested? Does it have a specification like what, like an LM80, to really make sure that the color over angle is going to be what you're going to expect it to be? Ask for color over angle. And the last one, what is the color consistency over time? And that is the 5 macadam that we want to focus on. So those are the 5 elements of quality of light that I wanted to discuss with you.